everybody. I'm Patricia Duff, and I'm very happy to welcome our many call-in audience members and our extraordinary guest speaker to the Common Good. As most of you know, many of you are Common Good members, and to those who are not familiar with the Common Good, our mission here is to help make our democracy better. A major piece of our effort is to provide a platform for reasoned debate and the free exchange of information, ideas, and analysis on the major issues of our day. This is so that we can help provide good governance and accountability. We support a vigorous free press, and most importantly, we encourage the active participation of all of our citizens in our national policy dialogue, because every individual can make a difference. Our guest today is someone who has been making a difference throughout her career, primarily in medicine and health policy. Dr. Kavita Patel knows healthcare and the role of government in our healthcare. Dr. Patel served in the Obama White House with Valerie Jarrett as Director of Policy for the Office of Intergovernmental Affairs and Public Engagement, and played a critical role in policy development and evaluation, focusing on health reform, financial regulatory reform, and economic recovery issues. Dr. Patel also served for many years on Senator Ted Kennedy's staff as Senior Advisor on Healthcare. She's currently a non-resident fellow at the Brookings Institution and a primary care physician in Washington, D.C. She's done extensive research and has a clinical background, having conducted research in healthcare quality and community approaches to mental illness that has given her a national recognition and reputation. So we are really, really excited to have Dr. Patel here, because this is a very dire and extreme situation, and we've been looking for answers. So let me just open this, Dr. Patel. Thank you so much for joining us. The country's been itching to get back to some kind of normal routine. And some locations are already planning on opening certain types of businesses. Can you give us the latest information on the best steps to shift to a more open situation? And tell us, are we ready?
Yeah, absolutely. Patricia, thank you. And thanks to Greg and everyone at Common Good. And thanks to all of you on a busy weekday, I'm sure, to kind of take time. So I'm going to try to hopefully make it high value. So I'll give just hopefully kind of shorter answers. I can go into any of them for much longer. But if folks have questions, we can get into that. But if not, I can go back and give a little deeper dive. So on getting back to reopening the economy, I think no matter where you are, you're going to want to look for several trends. And depending on where you're at in the country, some of these trends are starting to happen, but certainly not to where I think we can say, for example, that, you know, we should be reopening small businesses, or some of you have seen or might be in the state of Georgia, where I have dire concerns about the reopenings that are planned and projected for there. But you need three things to happen. The first is you need to start to see a sustainable decrease in what I'll call the R-naught, or even the R kind of infectivity rate of this virus, meaning you want fewer and fewer people to get infected by the virus. And that should be sustained not over 1 or 2 or 3 days. You really do want to see at least kind of 14 days of that sustained decrease in that number. The second thing is, while you're looking for that decrease in a number to reopen the economy, you have to have a testing strategy. So I live in the state of Maryland, work in DC, but you have to have a strategy to get tested. And I'll also, just as a side comment, say that everybody thinks a test is a test is a test. That's not true. When we talk about testing, we're talking about diagnostic testing, which means to check if you have the virus. We can put aside later, Patricia, the comment about immunity, because I know some of us have been checked to see if we have immunity and what that means. But when I talk about testing, we need to be able to test anybody who really needs a test. And I would argue everybody should get a test at some point. You should not have to have symptoms only to get a test, because we know that 1 out of 4 people don't have symptoms. So testing needs to be in place for the economy to reopen in your locality, your city, your state. And then the third thing is having a plan if you detect a hotspot. And that comes in the form in public health of what we call tracing. A lot of us are now, normally the kind of role of tracing is done by the public health department, when I was a resident at Oregon Health Sciences University in Portland, Oregon. I had to do public testing and tracing for tuberculosis because we had a bad strain in homeless populations of tuberculosis. So I had to go around with all this equipment and ask homeless people where they had been, who they had talked to, where they remember riding a bus. That's the kind of tracing we need to do. So those three things need, you need a plan for those three things in order to feel good about reopening the economy. And I can tell you right now, I'm from Texas. Texas does not have a plan, but the governor has went ahead and made an executive order to open up parts of the economy. I fear, and people smarter than me, like Dr. Tony Fauci, who leads the NIAID, whom all of us now probably know more than we know our own doctors. Dr. Fauci has said, and there have been cases in Kentucky and in other places where we've seen spikes after there has been a little bit of a relaxation of social distancing. But Patricia, before I sound like Dr. Doom and Gloom, we're there. We're getting there. I know it's been weeks. We're all frustrated. Trust me, I have privilege where I can be at home and work from home and talk to you. I still see patients, but I see them virtually as well as in person, which I can talk about what watching COVID patients looks like. But I'll just stop, Patricia, by saying that doing this for a couple more weeks at least will get us at least kind of, I would say, halfway through this battle. But we need to, I know that we're losing trillions. I understand that. But I also know that death is kind of the ultimate outcome that we need to avoid.
Well, it looks like what we're doing is we're still flattening the curve. That's what you're talking about. Exactly. But in terms of having the test that we need, are we doing what we need to be doing? I'm still stunned that we haven't really used DPA, the act to create these production of the supplies that we need, not only for testing for regular Americans, but for our supplies for our health workers and our... What's going on with that? How long are we going to be until we have the right stuff? And what should this really look like if you really have not just a plan for Texas, but a plan for the United States so that we know we're going to get these things that we need?
Yeah, and what I'll do to reflect on that, I worked, as you can tell, kind of on the early part of the Obama administration. And we have, if folks will remember, we had swine flu back then in that time period, 2009 to 2010, that we were dealing with. And so what we did, we actually did, and I was part of pulling together kind of our pandemic preparedness, and we call it the Public Health Emergency Measures Council. It's actually defense, the VA, health, Treasury, labor, everybody who's relevant kind of comes together and activates. And involved in that activation is standing up emergency operations centers. Also in parallel is to actually explore whether or not we need to mobilize the federal strategic national stockpile, which a lot of people have heard about. And I had to understand what that was a long time ago. And then the third aspect, which you're alluding to, Patricia, is if we need something that we do not have in our stockpile, or we need a new drug or a vaccine or a set of tests that we do not have access to, what can we do through the Defense Production Act? Do we need to invoke the Defense Production Act, number one? And if we do, how can we do it as quickly as possible and with what metrics we use? And everybody probably knows the kind of adage from World War II of car manufacturers like GM manufacturing planes or kind of vehicles and involved in assembling parts that were used for war. This is the same thing. We're essentially at a war with a virus. So the Defense Production Act has been invoked in the past, only in World War II, but already the president has cited that he would use it. However, it's only been until recently, in the last several weeks, that he's actually done it. First, it was for ventilators. And then yesterday, some of you may have followed in his daily task force briefing, he cited that they were going to be using the Defense Production Act. They didn't disclose with which manufacturer they were doing it with, but they were going to use it for the cotton swabs. I quickly countered, I've been spending a lot of time doing media, I quickly countered that it's not just the cotton swabs, it's also the reagents, the little plastic vials, which you need to process the chemicals, most of which come from, ironically, China or Italy. So I think, Patricia, you're asking, for those of you who are on a call and thinking about what does this reflect, in the past, and I hate to kind of make it seem like I'm saying Obama would have handled this better, I'm just telling you what we had been prepared for before. And what I don't see now is that sense of urgency from the beginning. I also see a world and an economy that is incredibly complicated from a global supply chain. And we've now pitted ourselves against other countries in racing for these supplies. So something that we had done during swine flu, which Ron Klain then improved upon for the Ebola response, was actually thinking about a federated strategy to buy supplies from other parts of the world, as well as, I'll call it a technology stack. It's something I've written about recently. We do not even have the spreadsheet. If those of you who've been watching the briefings, yesterday the president brought out a stack of papers and said, here's the list of labs, there's lots of labs. I don't understand in 2020 in the United States of America why we have anything on paper. And even worse, electronically, Patricia, if I wanted to know where I could find an excess capacity of masks, because there are places where we have excess capacity in this world, I can't even find that electronically. I have to call and rely on a bunch of open source Facebook groups. So one thing that I think that really was, three things that are a tragedy: not invoking DPA earlier. Number two, not having a federal strategy for global supply chain shortfalls, like reagents, like things made in Italy. And number three, not invoking the ability for technology to facilitate access to supply chain issues at an earlier point in time. What we've been doing has been nothing short, I will say this, and I'm not saying it dramatically, it's been nothing short of causing blood to be on people's hands, because they were deaths that could have been prevented.
Well, that's a really important point. And I wonder if you could just drill down a little bit about what would it look like if the Obama administration had been, if you're in the Obama administration or you're in the administration now, does it mean that you're asking 3M to make these supplies here, or, you know, yeah, in Maine doing, and who is overseeing all of this? Who is the, is it the CDC? Is it, you know, Mike Pence? How would that work in the best of circumstances? It's not working.
Yeah. Yet. And let's, you know, and I know at Common Good, you are in such, you really are encouraging thinking. And I will say, having been a veteran in Washington, D.C., I've got great friends on both sides of the aisle. So I'll tell you, here's how it should go. In any rational circumstance, regardless of party. Number one, you stand up kind of this massive like infrastructure internally through internal meetings. We would meet in the situation room, which I had never even been inside of until swine flu, but that's where you see those kind of dramatic scenes of catching like Osama bin Laden, and that's all in a very secure facility. We assemble kind of not just the parts of government, but quickly, Patricia, we assemble the best of the private sector. So all kind of, you know, really on the earliest signals, and the earliest signals in this case would have been the emerging data from Wuhan. I understand that we now think that the WHO and China had kept data back, but you can look back into December and November and see things that we should have acted on. So data would have informed kind of an internal assembly at the highest levels with security kind of briefings. And then at the same time, to your point, Patricia, we would have done a scanning of what's available federally, modeling of all the surge and the capacity, invoking the DPA. And it would have been going to 3M. It would have been going to the, you know, Becton Dickinson. There might be some of you on the phone, but the major manufacturers. Also something that's gone unnoticed, the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, waited until way too late in February to actually implement what's called emergency use authorization. They should have done that back in January. That allows for the Food and Drug Administration to work with private labs and manufacturers to actually accelerate or at least approve testing. And we should have been doing that much earlier, weeks earlier than the FDA did. So all of those things, Patricia, would have happened, not within hours, but within days early on, and would not have been used. That way the infrastructure, the FDA, the Defense Production Act, the conversation with the private sector, 3M, BD, Abbott Labs, Merck, who might be developing a vaccine, you know, all these manufacturers that we know by name, those people would have been activated and ready in case we needed it, which obviously we did. And then at the same time, there's a lot of controversy about the World Health Organization. They are incredible partners because they are on the ground in other countries that don't have the resources the United States does. So we would have worked initially with the WHO, with the non-governmental organizations who are out there delivering care, and gotten a pulse of what does this disease look like on the ground in China, in Taiwan, in Singapore, in South Korea. And I can't help but think, Patricia, I'm not a foreign policy person, but I can't help but think that what we saw now, Germany, South Korea, places, Iceland, places where testing and some of these things were dealt with earlier, very different cultures, but I can't help but think that if the United States, one thing that we would have done is brought State Department, USAID in, and they would have brought in some of those insights from their partners across the world. And I do feel like for me as an American, first generation, there's a critical lesson about this kind of notion that America can go it alone and America can do it all. And I think this virus has shown us that we can't. So those are the things that should have happened in the early days. And you, when you work in the White House, you have to write these briefing memos for the president. And it's incredibly hard to put everything in a memo for the man, maybe one day soon, hopefully a woman who wears that role and the responsibility. So I remember I was part of the team that put together the swine flu memo, and we had started, it was like 20 pages. And the staff secretary at the time said, no, the president needs like 2 to 3 pages tops. And I remember the first kind of bullet points at the top for his memo was, we're going to start to give you, Mr. President, kind of a, you know, red, yellow, green report every day on where we are. And it was on these metrics, you know, what is the public health community? What do we know about the disease? How prepared are we for it? What are we doing on treatments, vaccines? And I will say with pride, from the first day we understood that H1N1 would be a problem, 6 months later, we had a vaccine. That's not because we were smarter than everyone. We had resources we could rely on from things that were done before, which COVID doesn't. But we knew from the beginning that that was going to be the focus. And so, Patricia, I'm beating this a little bit, but I do think it's important for people to know that there could have been an alternative path. And I know I do not want to even say that we predicted the scope of COVID, but we did, after swine flu and after Ebola, we actually did do a memo for, I was not part of it at that time, I did the early part. They did a memo for the president to transition to President Trump, a document that said, you know, you should be prepared for a pandemic of epic proportions, and here's what we would recommend you do. So we knew what we needed to do, even when we didn't know what we were dealing with.
Are we at the point where the government is taking the steps that you would have done in a similar situation?
I think with the exception of the only thing I failed to mention is probably the most important thing if you're a regular human, which all of us are with COVID, is communication. So I know that the goal of the task force briefings are to be kind of in front of the American public. I still think the public is incredibly confused. And I also think that in our country, we have a health literacy issue. So even when we talk about things like immunity and antibodies, and I have to break it down for my patients in very basic terms, not because people are stupid, but you know, it's like when you hear the word cancer, your brain freezes and you can't process. And when people are thinking COVID, I actually know, like I've had patients that tell me like their heart rate goes up, they get really anxious. So I think we're failing. I think, Patricia, for better or for worse, we're there because a lot of governors have stepped up and said, okay, we're going to have to do this because the federal government.
Well, yeah. Governor Hogan has to have his wife as a contact in South Korea to get supplies that he needs. And it seems like we still have people on the front lines who are very concerned about whether they have the right kind of PPE to stay safe.
Right. That's right. No, you're right. So are we there yet? No, not necessarily, but we're probably not. I would say we're aware of all the issues. I don't know if we've taken executable action on all those issues, and we're seeing failures at leadership in many levels, but we are also getting more information on what we need, and people like you and, you know, even Common Good putting this out there, I think is helping to educate kind of what's missing. So really,
should we be making these things overseas, or should these be, or at the end of the day, should we be making these things in the United States so we don't have to worry about the supply chain?
I think that there's there's truth to the fact that we should be doing more domestically in general for certain parts of this, like the swabs, for example. But then there are aspects like the reagents, Patricia, where to actually create a new manufacturing facility and to do some of this would take the kind of resources that honestly, I just don't even know if we have today. But it is something, again, going back to kind of what I had to work on 12 years ago, we really did need to think about how to access these supplies at the federal level. When the United States government comes calling, people act very differently than when the state of Maryland's, you know, the governor's wife is calling on the phone for like 500,000 test kits. So I think there's some element that we will want to think about centralizing. That was actually the whole point of the Strategic National Stockpile, to be honest. It's not just the stockpile, but it's how do you produce what goes in the stockpile. There is something about this, though, that's going to always be global. And from an economic perspective, it doesn't make sense for us to do everything inside the United States. But it does make sense for us to think about the federated strategy if we need this. And by the way, Bill Clinton, I misspoke. Bill Clinton invoked the Defense Production Act during the West Nile virus. And those of you that are in the New Jersey, New York area will recall that that was obviously that was kind of a pandemic and a public health emergency. It didn't actually need to be used, but I believe he, and I have to go back and remember, but West Nile was another time when we thought this could spread and get a lot worse. And again, it points to the it points to my original kind of question you asked of, this is something that people have thought about. This isn't so new that we had to wait for weeks and months and drag our feet. And even still today, we're doing about 160,000 tests a day when we need to be doing, you know, somewhere just shy of a million.
Well, that takes me to something else too that I think we'd like to know from you. You've been on the front lines on this. Where are we in terms of the latest tests? I understand Abbott has something that may be a game changer in some ways. You know, treatments for the disease in the hospital. I mean, we may not want to do ventilators when you have lung issues. And vaccines. So give us a little, if you could go through the tests, the treatment in the hospital and vaccines as some of the things we can address.
Absolutely. And this is where you see some bright lines. Again, the reason why a critical kind of relationship between the government and the private sector is not because, you know, it's simply because the government is not going to be the place where you're going to see some of the most rapid deployment of capital for the goal of innovation. So innovation and testing. The FDA, as of today, has 42 tests that they've approved around diagnosing COVID or checking for immunity. I'll highlight a couple, not because of brand name, but just to give people hope. LabCorp, everybody knows LabCorp. LabCorp and Quest both offer the tests for both immunity and for diagnosing COVID. But today they just got approval for an at-home test to diagnose COVID. And it'll be some form of either you take a nasal swab or maybe even oral saliva to actually test for the RNA, the genetic material of the test, of the virus in that test. In the beginning, today it was approved. It's not gonna be, you know, available on Amazon anytime soon, or maybe at all, but it is gonna be available first to healthcare workers to get them tested quickly. And then hopefully in several weeks, they're going to deploy it through different channels to actual consumers. That's hopeful. Both the blood test, which tells you about immunity, and the diagnostic test, that crazy nasal swab or an oral swab. Both of them have versions by different manufacturers, Abbott being one of them, that get you a result in 15 minutes. But, you know, Patricia, not to kind of belabor what you said, but you need the swabs, you need the reagents, you need the kit. There's a lot of pieces that go into that. So it's not just as, you know, it literally is not an Amazon Prime kind of lab in a box. There's, you kind of have the lab, the kit, and then you need all the other things to do the testing. But it is great that we now have like basically anywhere you need it, a 15-minute turnaround on a potential solution only right now through a healthcare provider, which I say that because that can be a big bottleneck for any of us who have tried to get tests. So let me move to treatments. There are currently over about 82 treatments under investigation. There is no treatment that has been kind of FDA approved for non-investigational for the treatment of COVID-19. There's been a lot that's been made about the anti-malaria drug or the drug that you see in lupus or rheumatoid arthritis called chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine or Plaquenil. That got a lot of controversy because of early reports that it would work on COVID-19 patients. The FDA authorized for an investigational use to be used by COVID patients. It has a lot of kind of potentially bad side effects. And so far the data is not so great, but it is one of about 80 some odd treatments. Another one that got a lot of publicity is made by a manufacturer called Gilead, an antiviral called Remdesivir. And that has been showing in very early data. I'll caveat all this by telling you, not a randomized controlled trial. And all those patients in the data we saw were not intubated in the beginning. Sick, but not that sick. But they did show some response. But I also have been watching, there are trials for antibody drugs, antibodies from patients who have had immunity and they've drawn their blood and manufactured their blood and then put it into COVID patients. It's called convalescent serum. And that has been incredibly strong, early data. Another kind of set of drugs that works on the inflammatory pathway called IL-6, interleukin-6. It is another set of drugs that's incredibly strong to block whatever we think about the coronavirus is causing the inflammatory pathway. And just to give you a visual, I think all of us have seared into our brain that image of the coronavirus with like the red spikes. That's actually what it looks like. And it's called a coronavirus because of those spikes look like a crown. That's where the kind of genus, that's where the kind of species of these viruses got their name from. So the spikes that you see that cause the crown of the coronavirus actually kind of embed onto cells and cause that inflammatory response. So there are drugs that actually fight that inflammatory connection and have been also very promising. And then I'll shift to vaccines. There are multiple vaccine manufacturers with the very first vaccine trial launched in Kaiser Permanente for those of you on the West Coast, in the West Coast. And those are also already ongoing. And you may have heard now Dr. Fauci and others who have talked about the reality is that we won't see a vaccine till fall of 2021. You heard me just tell you about an H1N1 vaccine that took 6 months. Why is it taking 18 months for COVID? Several reasons. The H1N1, we built off of technology that had already been started. COVID is basically starting from scratch. And on top of that, there are just elements of viral vaccines that are tricky. And the safety profile, imagine giving something, imagine who would not want a COVID vaccine? I think it would be like the polio vaccine, one of the first times that everyone in the world arguably should get one. When you do something at that level, the safety profile needs to be so strong because you're always going to have down side effects, but you need to balance it with the positive. So the trials to check for the safety, which we want, I want, you want, are going to take a while. So the healthcare worker community will likely, healthcare worker and defense people, people at the front lines defending our country, are going to be the first wave of people to get the vaccine, maybe in a year. And then I would say that our America, our world is going to be in this new normal, Patricia, until the fall of 2021.
Well, it's you're actually giving us some good news that yes. Some of this is getting done. But one of the things that you just mentioned is things are going to look like as we go forward. And we do have some people starting to raise hands, so we will get momentarily. What's the new normal as we? Yep. I mean, we've got governors fighting with the government about whether they can open not, and some locations are already opening. As they open, what should they be doing, or is it possible for them to open safely?
I think, again, you're going to be looking for those kind of, there's the data, right? Decrease in cases of a certain amount, testing availability, but let's bring it more local to you and me. Even if I live in an area where the governor has said, you can go get a massage, you can go get your hair done, God bless you, go to restaurants. I think we're going to all, as people, have to take our safety kind of into, we're going to have to think about our safety ourselves. I don't know if we're going to be able to reliably just say, well, my governor told me I can go get my nails done, so I should go get my nails done. So I would say that you should, the most important thing, Patricia, is to actually, one, really identify how to stay safe, even when, you know, in places that are shared, whether it's work, subway, metro, Uber, and I think hand hygiene, all those things are going to still apply. The number two thing for returning back to work in spaces is going to be, how can you keep a safe distance? 6 feet is the number because it's really hard to see particles spread beyond 6 feet. Can it be done? Yes. But it's highly unlikely if you can keep a 6 foot distance. So we're going to have to think about returning to work, waiting in lines, and keeping some of that social distance. I'll also say, Patricia, I think no matter whether your county or city or neighborhood is wearing the non-medical masks, I'm inside, so I should have worn mine just to model it. But I would say getting comfortable, getting comfortable with wearing a non-medical mask in public, I would highly encourage it. I'm going to do it. I've got two little children who, you know, getting them to do anything is like a Herculean effort, but I ordered, you know, cute little masks for them. So I actually think getting used to that is going to be important for so many reasons, because flying on planes, things that you and I are hoping to do soon, trains, some of those things are going to look different, but if all of us could wear a mask, it'll dramatically decrease the ability to transmit. Doesn't take it away, but it makes it. The other thing that I think will be a new normal, we're not going to shake hands as much. I'm kind of a hugger. I'm used to actually even hugging my own patients. I'm not going to do that. You know, I think.
That's a shame.
I'm just being blunt about the fact that, you know, and I try to talk to my kids about this. I just think that we know what this can do. It's not going to be permanent. We are going to have a vaccine. I'm very confident because the amazing world minds working on it, there's no way that we can't beat this thing. So, but shaking hands, some of those things. I would say we're also going to be a lot more aware in restaurants and bars. I'm used to kind of going to my favorite neighborhood restaurant and getting crammed in. I'm going to expect that if my waiters are not wearing masks, I'm going to walk right back out. So I think we're going to be savvy consumers, you know, and I know this is going to sound terrible, but I think we're going to get comfortable with a little bit more of that social distancing, and you're going to see an overall decrease. You know, we're not going to be dying to go to concerts or fighting to get into crowded spaces the way we might have. Think about Christmas shopping. You know, I'm not going to want to go to a mall. I'm not going to want to fight in a parking lot. I'm just not going to want to do the things that I would say are pretty American. And it's largely because I think it's not worth the risk.
Well, I can understand that. We do have a couple of questions.
Yeah.
Richard Solomon, do you want to go?
Sure. Thank you very much, Dr. Patel. Very insightful. You make a powerful case for a national policy, which sadly I don't believe we're going to get. As a policy expert, how would you advise a governor of a forward-thinking state like New York or the Northeast or the West or some of the states in the Midwest who are worried about the fact that you are having the risk of spread from people who in the states you mentioned, Georgia, South Carolina, Tennessee, Florida, you name it, may not care for their own well-being, but who have the risk of adding to the contagion for the elderly, infirm, or many others in those states like New York?
Yeah, absolutely. Great question. I've thought about it. I've been, in full disclosure, I've been working with some states, some of which you've mentioned, and talking with all the governors have some sort of council in their, you know, New York has one, Maryland has one, et cetera. So I've been working with some of the states' councils on that exact topic. Number one, I think that it's very reasonable in the state of California, some of you are in California, have done this, that visitors by air, by train, by kind of transit have been flagged and identified that unless they come with some proof of immunity, they actually do need to kind of self-isolate for 14 days. I don't think that's unreasonable. I think that it's obviously hard, you know, the borders are complicated. So I know having National Guard standing at your border of between look at DC, Maryland, and Virginia. I understand it's not practical in some cases to do it, but I would strongly encourage every governor. I have encouraged states that I've consulted with, not for money, but just to work with. I have told those states, you should think very carefully about sending a strong signal that if you come from any state and you do not know about your own status, that you need to kind of shelter in place by yourself for at least 14 days to ensure that you don't infect any of our people. And then I would say that certainly, Richard, in hotspot kind of, we now know nursing homes, healthcare facilities, we know that these are places, densely crowded places, juvenile detention centers, all of those places, there should be a strict, absolutely no flexibility policy on getting those workers tested, getting residents tested, and I would argue and have universal masking even in those facilities. So I think prisons should have universal masking. I think any densely crowded kind of residential facility like a nursing home, which most of them have, by the way, gone to universal masking. And then at a governor's level, I've also recommended transparency and reporting. Even states, you know, that I have a lot of respect for, like California, up until last Friday, did not transparently report kind of nursing homes and where people were getting infected. And this isn't to kind of, you know, label people, but people need to know, and we've already seen that those can be kind of critical areas. So those are the recommendations we're giving in real time. And then I've been trying to work with large employers. I'll give you a great question. What would you do if you were Disney and you had to reopen, think about reopening your park? How do you do that? We know that those thermometers and infra scanners don't tell you that much. They're helpful if someone has a rip-roaring fever, but not to tell you if they've got COVID. So how do we reopen parts of the economy? So there are a set of us who have been working with employers to also think about what kind of policies do you need to put into place? And I would urge, and I have urged other governors and states to think about what they need to do to support their largest employers, because they need to think about how to get the economy back up as well, but they can't do it without kind of a partnership with their state or cities. I know a lot of mayors are doing this on their own because the states are kind of defaulting to them.
Actually, Sarah had a question about that that relates to that. What about children in schools? Are they gonna be wearing masks? Are they gonna be social distancing? Are they gonna be able to go back to school?
Yeah, it's a great question. Luckily, a good girlfriend of mine is one of Tony Fauci's number two, and her daughter and my son are in the same school. So we have this conversation. The more we're working from home and trying to school our children, the more I call her and I tell her, like, when are we getting our kids back to school? And I'm laughing because part of me selfishly just needs them to go back to school to get a little bit of normalcy to my life. But she made a very strong point with my kids' school's principal, that we're going to need to kind of move children, especially over the age of two, which all school kids are, to masking or getting comfortable with masks. But even it's hard to keep kids 6 feet apart. That's just not realistic. So I think that if your state hasn't already done it, Patricia, the school year, including college, high school, obviously that's completely ended. But whether it's summer school or the fall, I think what we're looking at is trying to do kind of rotations where we'll only have certain percentages of the school meeting so that you kind of minimize the number of kids that are there should there be a hot spot. So everybody's talking about kind of integrating virtual learning with kind of in-person events, no congregations. You know, it might need, the problem I think for many schools is going to be the student to teacher ratio, because we're going to have to break apart classrooms of 30 into smaller pieces. And some of that might be virtual, some of that might be physical, but it does create an incredibly hard logistics issue. And by the way, that applies to universities. It applies to any of you who do your business in larger settings. I would just say that meetings of larger than 10, and I'll tell you there's science behind 10, you're going to have to rethink that completely by using part virtual, part in person.
Okay, Karen, let's have your question, please.
Hi, thank you so much. This is very helpful. Quick question. I've been reading several studies, one by Vizient, one by Premier, that indicate that there is currently a shortage of medications that are used with ventilators. It's right. Not getting a lot of press, but in pockets it is. Uh-huh. Is the FDA doing enough? Do we have another crisis coming along? And what do we need to do, or what can we do now to get in front of the curve?
Yeah, it's a great question. And a lot of this are the medications that actually go down kind of the endotracheal tubes themselves, as well as there's a shortage, believe it or not, of even, you know, those of us who use, I don't, but the metered dose inhalers, the ones you use as
Albuterol.
For yeah. asthma, exactly. There's shortages of those, which is one of those drugs that you do use inside of ventilators, but also use for asthma. So you're absolutely right. These are generic drugs. So this is not like a, you know, someone's hoarding them to make money off of them. There's just truly a supply, a shortage. Good news here is that private manufacturers of generic pharmaceuticals actually have come together in the last several weeks to try to identify, you know, one, how can, unfortunately, a lot of our manufacturing of drugs goes on in India and China. And so there have been kind of constraints on those supplies. The Strategic National Stockpile, and now many states have also kind of taken over. And then I'm part of, it's a group of health systems that actually have put their own money. They started this several years ago, by the way. It wasn't because of COVID, but it's coming into handy now. Several health systems have kind of gone in together to form an alliance to actually manufacture drugs in shortage. So they're taking a hand in this as well. So I'm not going to say I feel great that, you know, we're not going to have a shortage, it's going to be fine, but this actually might be one of the things that, because of private sector solutions, as well as the public sector not wanting to keep continuing to make the same mistakes, has gotten a little bit savvier about. Interestingly enough, though, hospitals are seeing shortages of also some basic things like IV fluids and things that, you know, you would think, why can't we have enough of that? So that is another area that is actively being monitored. And again, through private and public sector, they're trying to get ahead of it.
How about Gerald? I think Gerald has a question for you. Go ahead, Gerald.
Thank you. I'm wondering how rapidly you think we can get testing up to a level you think is sufficient to feel comfortable opening up the country, like everywhere in the country.
And Gerald, I heard something about what level of testing? Was it number?
When you mentioned before about being able to take tests at home, for example, that was exciting. What I'm wondering is, you know, how fast, because we keep hearing we're just not doing enough testing.
Right.
How fast can we get up to a level of testing you think is sufficient where we all could feel comfortable in this new normal, you know, prior to the vaccine coming?
Yeah. Yeah. Got it. Okay. So I'll answer that by simply saying that, again, right now we actually still use criteria for giving people a test. If you're a healthcare worker, great, you get a test. But otherwise, and in fact, I've done this. I've done the mystery shopper thing where I've called my own clinic and said, can I get a test for COVID? And you basically have to have symptoms. I mean, you still have to have symptoms. So I would say, Joe, this will not be at an acceptable level until literally we were told anybody in America who wants a test can get a test. And that's actually the right answer. We just can't do it today. So we need to be able to make good on that. But with 350 million Americans that we know of and many, you know, many parts of the country where we think we might have 400 million Americans as well, we don't have enough. I'm not saying all 400 million of us need to get a test every day, but the truth is that you're not just going to need a test once, because let's say Patricia tests negative today. She's going to want to know if that flight she took from San Francisco and someone was coughing, she's going to want to know if she's gotten infected. So I think that we need to have at least the ability to do anywhere from 1 million to 1.5 million tests a day. And that in order to do that, to Patricia's earliest comment about Q-tips and swabs and reagents, I don't think I'm going to feel better until we know that we have multiple options to do testing, including spitting into a little tube at home, because all it needs is saliva, and that can be used. And so sadly, parts of our country are reopening without that capacity. I do think that we are probably 4 weeks, maybe longer, away from having enough tests all over the country. That's the truth. And I know that that's not good, which is why I have told my own family, my parents, my medical advice always comes down to what would you do if you were me, you know, and what would I do if I were in your shoes? I've told my own parents who are in their late 70s and early 80s to stay at home through May. And I myself am going to, you know, our kids, testing, I do not think will be where we want it. And then I should just make, I'm sorry, I know there's questions. Let me make a comment about testing itself. Dr. Deborah Birx said something that I think is incredibly profound. Even if a test is, quote, 99% specific, which usually tells you if you can rule a disease in, that specificity or sensitivity of that test working depends on the prevalence in your population. So there is no 100% test. So these tests should not give you false comfort. They're data points that are helpful, but we need to have, which is why I still think even if you told me I could get a test tomorrow and every single day thereafter, I still think until we understand a little bit more about immunity and what that means, that I would still practice social distancing.
It's still pretty grim.
Oh, no, not grim. No, not grim. Just, again, I think all these things just kind of are triggers for me to be patient, because we have a long life we're going to want to live. And I don't want to see us shortchange it because we're so pent up. And, you know, I didn't get to talk about the mental health part of it, but it's real. And I worry that we've got a lot of people out there who are depressed and anxious and not sleeping. And so I'm not trying to make them feel grim. I actually think you take this as a bit of ownership so that you can control this and not feel like so much is out of your control. You getting a test might be out of your control. You wearing a mask, and maybe it's not 6 feet, Patricia, but it's, you know, keep a distance. And then I would say have like a virtual kind of social unit, have a couple of other people that you take the risk to have dinners and have some social contact again that have been pretty vigilant about their own health and are not high risk, and start to kind of resume some normal semblance of life by, you know, being around people where you haven't been for a while.
Right. So there are a number of people who ask whether you can get the disease again, or if you have some immunity, how long immunity lasts, if we know enough about that to say.
Yeah. Okay. So here's what the science tells us. We know that people do develop immunity, and there's different forms of antibodies that show us that. We do not know if that's lifelong, because we haven't had people with lifelong disease. We think that immunity is going to last us at least months, hopefully years. And here's why. The virus is not mutating as rapidly as the influenza virus is. So we know that it's actually stabilized in its structure and in its actual RNA. And that's been a hopeful sign that it is something that if you do catch and develop immunity, or if we have a vaccine, that we can get herd immunity with the combination of people who have recovered from it, as well as a vaccine for maybe healthcare workers. We're optimistic that this is something we can have kind of hopefully long-term immunity for. And remember, you know, you hear people tell you, I got the flu shot and I got the flu. That's actually the point. The flu or any of these other vaccines are either live or killed forms of these viruses or bacteria. And that's actually how you develop immunity. You inject your body with a little bit of it, you develop a reaction that gives you immunity. And so we're hopeful that with COVID, if you've had it, that immunity lasts you and prevents you from reinfection. The stories you've seen of reinfection, we think, are people that had false negatives at some point in their testing, or had a subclinical form of the infection that wasn't picked up by the testing and then kind of flared. So there's very kind of, but that's something we're all watching very closely to look at reinfections and whether they're real or not.
There are so many more questions from our community that I have. This has just been so illuminating and so helpful. And you actually have given us a lot of silver linings in this conversation. So I want to thank you so much. And thank everybody who's been on the call. We've had Fred Hochberg, the former Ex-Im Bank president, was on the call. I wish I could have gotten to him before he got off. But we do need to close. I want to thank you, Dr. Patel. I hope we can have you back.
Yeah, I'm happy. And if people, there's no pride in them. I'm happy. My email is pretty easy. I'm happy to give that away and let people contact me. I don't believe information should be isolated. So I'm happy to share. It's not my wisdom. I'm drawing from science and something I wish more of our leaders would do, but I'm drawing from kind of research and evidence, not my own opinion per se. So anything I can do to be helpful, please let me know, Patricia.
Well,
thank you for the service you give.
Thank you. Thank you so much. We hope we see you again. And thank you all for joining us. Till next time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Patel.
Thanks, Greg.